Hello everyone, and welcome to the Dice Commando YouTube channel. I'm Andrew, with you here as always. This is Go Again, a fabulous video cast covering the trading card game Flesh and Blood. This video and others like this one are possible thanks to viewers like you. Please show your support with a like and subscribe, and be sure to hit the bell notification icon so you don't miss any new videos. If you want to get involved with the channel, consider becoming a channel member. There are many benefits to channel membership, including access to our Discord, exclusive deck tech and strategy videos, and the opportunity to help create channel content. I want to sincerely thank all our channel members, as I truly couldn't do this without your support. You guys rock. Go Commando. Hello everyone, welcome to Dice Commando and Go Again, a fabulous cast, our Flesh and Blood focused cast here on the channel. So, I know that we're right at the start of spoiler season and everyone's super excited about all the new sexy. But we were having a conversation on the Discord, kind of over the Dice Commando Discord, over kind of the last week or so about Dorinthea and her strength. Obviously, she's really good in Blitz, I think. And a lot of the guys are saying she's broken. She very well, and by broken, I just mean overpowered above curve. And she very well may be, but I was kind of trying to explain to them why she's a little harder to set up from a straightforward standpoint than it may be in terms of using her sword. So that's what I wanted to do today, was kind of go over some initial Dorinthea strategy, and I was kind of explaining to them how I try and play her a little different, because it works better for me in terms of just value. So that's just what I want to go through today, is revisiting Dorinthea. Alright guys, so welcome back. Thanks again for joining me today for our in-focus Dorinthea Revisited, whatever you want to call it, right? So, again, let's just focus in on her Dawnblade, because at this point we all know really what Dorinthea does and all that, but Dawnblade, let's just dissect this, right? There's not a lot to it. It's a 1-for-3, which is pretty much in line with most of the cards, right? Most cards out there are kind of a 1-to-3-ish ratio, at least the better ones. So the card itself is in line. What's really cool is when you can start stacking the attacks because of Dorinthea's ability, of course. And then once this thing gets counters on it and really starts to sing, right? It can really be a major threat, right? No question about it. So let's actually start with this graphic that I'm throwing up right now, which is Dorinthea's an ideal Dorinthea, like a textbook ideal Dorinthea turn, right? Is you throw out a 3-pitch, you drop a Valor, which gives +3 to the weapon, the next attack, and then if it hits, it gets go again. And then, so you take 1 for Valor, take 1 to swing with Blade, it hits, and then you pay 1 for Blade, right? This is like a textbook perfect turn for the Warrior. You get to swing for 6 for 2, you get to swing for 3 for 1, and then you put the counter on it, and then ideally you would rinse, wash, repeat over and over and over again, right? So that's the textbook goal of what we're really driving towards here, right? And then, of course, you can start adding in other things. You could do a Sharpened Steel setup to give an additional +3 and potentially swing for 9, but that's a 3-card combo now, assuming you have a 3-pitch, or you can Iron Song Response as the attack react, again, swing for 9 total. So again, but now you're getting into the 3-card thing, which means you can only defend with one card. Now you're probably depending on an arsenal and so on, right? Certainly not impossible to do. We've seen people do that and even crazier things for sure, right? But again, looking at this, even in this, I mean, in this case, what we're showing right now are Iron Song Response, Turbine Steel as the extra card, which are 0 drops, right? And this is a very idealized scenario, and it certainly happens, no question about it, but it's not as reliable, right? That's the main thing Dorinthea brings, in my opinion, to the table, is her overall reliability, right? Because you don't need to drop cards to attack, you can just swing, right? So it's not about finding your attack, it's about finding the stuff to help your attack, right? If that makes sense. So kind of how I play her more, because, well, let's go into the problem statement first, right? The problem statement is, if you look all her cool tech, which I'm showing right now, right? So Sharpened Steel, Iron Song Response, great, there's zeros. Razor Reflex is also one I play a lot. I think a lot of other people do as well, right? Again, it's that 1-for-3. It's a 1-for-3 attack react. You then have Singing Steel Blade for 1, which is great. It lets you do, basically, it's a +1 and lets you tutor that red Sharpened Steel. Like, that's basically the play there. You also have Steel Blade Supremacy, but again, that costs 1. So that's eating into the set, right? Anytime you pay 1, it eats into that second attack, even if you throw a 3-pitch, right? And now you have to find another card somewhere. And Bracers, right? Bracers, I don't think is. I mean, Bracers is good. Don't get me wrong, and it's great to have it there. But your next weapon, for one, your next weapon attack gains plus one, and you can only use it if you've hit, right? So now you're using that to buff your second attack, which means that you're pitching another card. No question about it. You're pitching at least a two, right? I mean, that's really, really, because you still have to have done something to have it go again, which is going to cost you at least one. You have to swing, so now you're at two. And then maybe you're getting the third attack, so now you're pitching another card, right? And like, I don't know where all this pay is coming from, right? And that's kind of the problem. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's a problem that every hero has, is how are you paying for all this stuff? But stacking it with Dorinthia, like, the ones start to add up, right? I mean, that's just basic resource management. I mean, it is the way it is, right? And so that's what I'm saying, is that she has a lot of, it's not as easy to pull off all this stuff. You have to really set it up. You have to basically take a turn off and make sure you have the right card in your arsenal, which, again, yes, guys, I understand is how all the heroes play. But that's my point, is that's how all the heroes have to play. They have to basically sack a turn, set himself up for the big swing, and do it. Now maybe Dorinthia is more reliable in that sense. Maybe so, and that's completely fair. But that's the problem we start running into, is you end up spending that dollar that you need for your second sword swing on something to help you be able to swing the second time. Right, because again, you don't get to swing again unless it hits. Right, that's how all of it works. So, that's really, you know, that's what I'm showing here. Right, the three pitch, one cost, and you can swing again because you hit. Congratulations, but you can't pay for it. Right, so unless you didn't defend, or you got something good out of arsenal, or you had some item down or something like that, it becomes a little more difficult, and you're certainly not using your bracers. Right, I mean, that's the reality of it, is I find that a lot of the games I don't use my bracers very often. Right, it just it's kind of a bummer that it's that legendary card, and it's such a good looking card, but I don't find I use it all that often. But again, maybe I'm just playing it wrong. So into kind of my discussion on how my Dorinthia deck has evolved based on that problem statement. I really like the cards. I mean, Scar First Scar, everybody loves the card, the red pitch version. No secret there. But I play it in Dorinthia. I play Snatch. I like that. And I play Wounding Blow, right? What you'll see, I play the red pitch for all of these, right? You'll see something very familiar about these. They all have zero, and all but one of them has go, or does not have go again, right? They're just zero cost finishers, right? In of themselves, they're not super sexy, right? I mean, zero for four is not bad, don't get me wrong, but no go again and stuff like that. So, I mean, Scar for Scar is a whole different thing, right? People play that for the Gokan, right? But these cards in and themselves aren't great. But what they really help me do a lot in Dorinthia is this, right? To add on to that scenario before, right? So I did my three pitch. I set everything up, but they were able to block. I had to spin something to attack to get it to hit. Okay, now I still have go again, but I can't pay for my extra swing, but I can do Wounded Blow. Right now, yes, I understand. I could pitch Wounding Blow and swing for three here, but if I think they're going to block, then I can play Wounding Blow and I can just sneak in the extra attack. Right, and that's, I mean, so again, I realize that there's a trade-off there, but throwing the four in usually means you can punch through. It is a lot easier for people to block a three, because you know you don't have. If I'm pitching my last card, a lot of times they know you don't have anything to come over the top of it, so they'll drop a 3-4. And the other reason that these cards work is that they can be sitting in your arsenal, and you can just basically play it as an emergency valve, right? Because remember, you can't pitch from arsenal, right? So that's where the zero cost comes in. It's like, I'm out of cards in hand. That card's just been sitting there in the arsenal waiting to go. I throw it in after the attack, right? That's how that works. So, and then and remember, if it's not hitting, you're not getting that bonus. You're not getting the bonus counter, okay? So, and then you run into the problem of what happens on those turns where you don't have a 3-pitch in your hand, right? I mean, everything we've been talking about to this point is predicated on the fact that I have a 3-pitch in my deck. And what happens if I don't, right? And that's where the Scar for Scar comes in, right? You can Scar for Scar chain into Dawnblade, and that's not a bad turn in and of itself, right? So you swung for 4, maybe they blocked it. It gets go again no matter what. Now it's left, you have you less health, I grant you that. But Scar for Scar into Dawnblade cost you 1 and you swung for a total of 7 into attacks, that's not too bad, right? And then on top of that, we have Vest of the First Fist, right, which has kind of taken over the, I used to play Backbone Strapping, or Barkbone Strapping, or whatever it is, right, but I used to play that, which lets you kill it to reduce the cost of an action by 2, which usually you're only using it for 1, like a Valor or something, right? But Vesta First Fist, I've started playing this because if I do that scar for scar thing, I can sack it and I can get money for Dawnblade or whatever other tricks I may have in my hand. Or, I mean, maybe it's a low turn and I just need to, right, maybe scar for scar is all I have left, whatever. It just helps me eke it out. So that's another one of the tricks that I've picked up since Arcane Rising came out. And then so looking through, right, to go to, shout out to fabdb.net, I just went in, I did their browse, and I set up a search criteria for basically anything that was a zero cost with four or more. And of course, the big one that comes up is E-Strike. I have that highlighted there because that's the Majestic. And it, I mean, it's better than their cards. Like, there's no question about it. Like, zero for five there, plus some really cool options, including the Go Again, if you need it, right? Obviously, if you have E-Strike, you're playing it here over one of those other two. I do like Snatch, though, right? Because the whole thing is, if this is happening, a lot of times you're doing it on your last card. So the reason I like Snatch is because if it hits, you do get to draw a card, which you can then arsenal, and it just helps you out, potentially, right? So I do like that. Winning Blow, you'd certainly swipe out for E-Strike, but, I mean, E-Strike, again, it's not super necessary here. It's better, but it doesn't necessarily destroy the strategy that I'm proposing here if you don't have it, if you're on more of a budget build. So that's pretty much it. So that's just kind of what I wanted to do for a rundown of, you know, Dorinthea has her problems too. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I love her because she's reliable. Like, everybody has weapons in, but I'd rather pay one for three than I would pay two for the Ninja Kodachis, right, back-to-back, for one apiece, right? So, yes, in two different attacks, which hurts their blocking. I grant you that, but I don't know. I like the one for three. So that's where I'm at. It does seem to be really good in Blitz so far, at least from the limited Blitz games that we've played. Just always having that there, always being consistent. She can just keep coming at you, keep coming at you, keep coming at you. So anyway, let me know what you're thinking. Am I crazy here? Am I just playing her completely the wrong way? And obviously, I'm not winning any Road to Nationals or anything, so I get that. But anyway, let me know your feedback. If nothing else, go Commando.